Hey, this is Tom and Jimmy from Bob Moses.
And you're watching Stingray PausePlay.
I am B. Zach Monson, and welcome back to a very special edition of Stingray PausePlay here with Canada's very own Bob Moses.
Hey, man.
Hi, howdy. Gents.
How you doing?
Neither of which are Bob and or Moses. Why don't you tell your real names and tell us what you do in the band?
I'm Jimmy. I play lead keyboards and tambourine.
And I'm Tom, and I sing and play guitar.
I'm sure you can also play tambourine, though.
I'm trying, but I take tambourine lessons from Jimmy. Like,
okay.
We have a portion of the day in each tour day where, okay, like, 30-minute tambourine lessons.
I'm getting there. And he just says, shake, and then you... Okay.
No, he's got precise measurements. It's pretty high-tech. I won't give away all his secrets.
I'm ambidextrous. I can do both.
Both hands?
Yeah.
Wow. Great. You're lucky in all kinds of levels.
I know. It's great.
Tell me about two Canadian high school buddies meeting up in the parking lot in a bad part of New York City.
I mean, it was pretty great. It was crazy. And, you know, New York's one of those cities that, like, if you see your lost Canadian friend, you definitely gravitate to each other, kind of like polar bears on ice caps, you know, when they're just floating out there. So we ran into each other in a Lowe's parking lot and decided to start making music together. On the spot. Well, we were just why don't you come to the studio? It's like, yeah, we...
There was, like, fireworks and slow music. And
Like,
everything went in slow-mo.
A little bit of wind.
Yeah, it was one of those. Tom was thinking about moving back to Canada, and my roommate had just moved out, so I said, hey, why don't you come live with me for a bit? We'll give this whole Megan music thing a shot. And here we are a couple years later.
Do you remember the very first time you guys met each other, ever?
Ooh, I don't.
No, I don't. We would have been like...
I'd just like to add, Jimmy also threw in the offer of tambourine lessons.
Oh, that was the clincher.
In the initial...
I don't know if I want to live with you or make music, but free lessons.
Okay. It's part of the deal.
I don't remember when we met, but I do know that it would have been in, like, elementary school, because we both went to the same school. I was in grade 6, Tom was in grade 7, so we would have met some point there, but we didn't, like, start hanging out until, like, grade 11, 12.
Yeah.
In high school.
I remember, like, we had the same art class. So I remember being in grade 12 and Jimmy in grade 11 and, like, you know, him being in art class and us.
Oh, no, he was just our school had the thing where there wasn't, like it had small grades. So they would put, like, 11 and 12, 10, whatever, together for some classes.
Because it's art, you know, like, you know, it's kind of like the thing that you go and do and, like, gotcha. Oh, nice gotcha. Art, you know.
Maybe Tom would inspire me, I don't know. They, like, want to put the older kids in with the, like...
I have no doubt he did.
Yeah, he did. Definitely.
I have no doubt he did. Yeah. You know, it's hard to make it as a band, making it small or making it big. How do you guys push through the tough times and keep going without killing each other?
Well, it's always fun. Like the tough times are fun and the good times are fun. And if you just take them both, you know, if you take everything kind of with a grain of salt and just always keep it fun, I think that just makes it that much better. And, like, you know, we just kind of laugh. The stuff that when it gets tough, we just kind of shrug it off and laugh it off.
It's also nice to have a part, like a partner.
You can say life partner. It's okay.
I could say life partner.
You can say life partner.
Life partner. I wasn't going to say life partner. I just said nice and partner in the same.
Yeah.
Anyways, it's nice to have a partner because when the tough times are tough, you can kind of laugh about it or keep it in perspective.
So, speaking of killing each other or not killing each other, we asked the last artist to ask you a question.
Yeah. Okay.
And that question is...
Hi, I'm Martha Wainwright, and my question for you is... would you like to be buried or cremated when you die?
Well, that's a good question.
Cremated.
I'd rather be cremated, yeah.
Why?
I think just for, like, I know some people...
Being buried is gross.
Yeah, well, that's kind of weird. Like, what if you're not actually dead?
Ah.
You know?
Okay.
What if you're just like a...
What if you're just like in Monty Python when they're just kidding?
Okay.
Yeah, and then...
I'm not really dead.
And, like, I want to make sure, like, I'm just gone.
So you want them to finish you off?
Finish me.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. I don't want there to be any chance of, like, waking up going, why am I in a box?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I pretty much guarantee that won't happen, but it's okay to be afraid of that. It's okay.
Jimmy has like...
I have irrational fears of
things. He wakes up in the tour bus sometimes. Well, now we have condo bunks.
Okay.
We started with smaller bunks.
Yeah.
And Jimmy would, like, wake up being like, I'm in a box.
Yeah.
You know? Because it's pretty dark, you know. Yeah. You put your little...
And you, like, you leave, you put your hand out, it's like there's a wall. There's another wall. I'm in a box, you know. Like,
yeah. There's these things that were invented called lights that you can actually get. that would help.
I heard
that
about
situation.
Those. Yeah. Yeah. Pretty cool.
They're pretty amazing.
We're like, if we sell out a few more shows, we're going to have enough money to do lights in the bus. It's going to be great.
That's amazing. You guys are on your way. The album is Days Gone By, and every song to me sounds like it's the theme song to whatever the next best TV show is.
Great.
Thank you.
It's such a great album. It's electronic. It's kind of not electronic. It's also good enough to stand alone as just music. So why the choice to not just be producers, but be songwriters as well?
Because we love songs.
Yeah, it's just sort of natural.
There's, it's like writing songs is really fun. And then finding kind of like a cool shell or like this electronic, half electronic thing to like kind of be the vessel in which to put the songs in. It's just fun. And it's challenging, and like there's a lot of great producers out there, and I think sometimes like now it's like people are like, oh, we're gonna get these people to write the song, this person to produce it, and it's all kind of very divided. But for us, it's just kind of natural.
I think it's like it's just kind of like us doing what we think is awesome. It's like Josh Homme from Queens of the Stone Age always used to say, like, you gotta make the music that you want to hear that's not out there, awesome music. So we kind of like just try and take all the different parts of stuff that we love and what's inspiring us and kind of channel that through our own creativity, you know?
Tell me about the song Before I Fall a bit.
Well, we actually were inspired by hearing another track that was actually for, like, they put a teaser commercial for a festival that we were playing.
Okay.
And there was a song in that teaser commercial that we were like, that's really cool. And we'd never heard of it before, and I haven't heard the artist, and like still, like, I don't think there's anything else that artist put out or anything that we heard, but like this one track, we're like, this is kind of cool. What if we did something sort of similar to it? And of course, when you try to, like, when you're inspired by something, it ends up going down some different path.
Yeah.
So it ended up sounding completely different in the end. But we really loved like where that led us. So it was one of those things that came together pretty quick. And, I remember there was a point where, like, one of us started humming the guitar line, and we tried playing it on a synth and tried playing it on different things, and then Tom picked up a guitar and was like, you know, just wailed this riff out, and we were like, that's awesome. And it just kind of, it was also one of those things, I think we ended up piecing a song that was, like, written before on acoustic guitar. Like, Tom had written an idea on acoustic guitar, and we started making, like, a beat maybe for a different idea.
Yeah.
And we just kind of married the two together. Yeah. Like, sometimes that happens a lot for us. We'll write songs and then write sort of beats and stuff. Sometimes they end up getting, like, you know, pieced together in this kind of Frankenstein thing in the end. And that's always really fun when that happens. When, like, you start singing a melody you wrote, like, maybe 2 months ago over something that you made today. And you're like, wow, this is awesome. Like, the worlds are, like, everything's coming together just great, you know? Yeah. What do you have to, anything to add there?
I remember a quarter of that.
Okay. All right. Well, good thing you guys have each other then to fill in each other's memories.
Maybe it happened. Maybe it didn't. Who knows?
Yeah. But it was a good story.
Yeah.
It sounded like it was awesome.
Sounded really fun.
Yeah.
The album is, you know, being received really, really well by a lot of different people. Have you guys had people reach out to do collaborations with you now?
Yeah. We've been asked to produce and write for some people. And
any names that you haven't signed Do Not Discloses for yet?
Well, we've been asked to collaborate with local natives, those guys.
Very cool.
A bit.
Yeah, they're great.
The thing is, like, all the people that have asked us, we've been like, whoa, that's, yeah, we want to work with you.
We just don't have the time.
We haven't had the time because we've been, like, you know, on the road, road dogging it.
And we're very, like, you know, we want to do a good job, and we're not very good at the whole, like, set up a laptop in a bus or something and just half-ass it. We like to, like, you know, dive in and dissect stuff and make it really... I don't know. It's too difficult for us. And we always have to be like, guys, look, we love you, but we just can't. I don't know.
We went to dinner with Tovlo.
Oh, wow. Awesome.
And we are going to try and maybe just write some stuff. She's like, she's got her artist thing, but she's also like, I don't know if other people know that, but she's like written lots of,
she's done a lot of writing,
tons of stuff for other people and stuff. So it's cool to kind of like pick her brain a bit about how that whole world works. Cause when we first started, before we sort of found our Bob Moses sound, we were like thinking, oh, well, maybe we'll just be producers, or maybe we'll just write for other and produce for other people. So we kind of had a wide array of sounding stuff that we had written.
Yeah.
And so we've always kind of flirted with that idea in the back of our mind of maybe once we stop touring so much and we have some time, we'll do some sort of other writing, producing stuff. So I mean, those are a couple names. There's more, but yeah.
Very much looking forward to that.
We'll see.
Yeah.
Speaking of that Bob Moses sound, you guys have added a few things to your live show, whether it's a drummer or other kinds of things. In a few years, what is the like ultimate Bob Moses that you can think of? What is your ultimate live show going to look like?
15 swan dancers.
Okay, yeah. That's what I assumed.
Flying like pterodactyl things.
Okay.
That could...
Like pterodactyl things or pterodactyls?
If we can get some of those imported, then okay. Definitely. But okay, yeah. I hear they're kind of tricky about that in the border, usually.
Yeah. I remember we just played with Kygo at the Hollywood Bowl on Friday. And like the guy... There's so many things on stage that can hurt you.
Yeah, okay.
Like, there's like...
And there's like a lot of fire.
There's a lot of fire. Scary. And like I was walking out front like during sound check, and there's like... 80 confetti cannons just like lined up at the front, and like what if one of them just decided to just go off and like take me out, you know, like yep. You know
then
what?
It's your time, bro.
There will also be a person in Jimmy's ear to be like, don't worry, the confetti cannons will not blow up now.
But you know what, I think it was
you're
even
not in a box.
Definitely full time one
in Montreal, wasn't it, that James Hetfield got burned by a pyro during a Metallica concert?
It happens.
Yeah. I'm pushing it for happens. The pyro. Jimmy's resisting the pyro.
And that's Metallica. We'll so if Metallica is gonna get burned,
your music doesn't really scream pyro. No,
you'd be surprised.
Though.
You'd be surprised.
No, I don't. We're not really into the whole pyro thing. But our manager is always like, "Get pyros! Get I love pyro. Fire!" And we're like, okay. "Nah."
You'd be like, "You're fired."
Yeah, you're fired.
You're scaring me right now. Yeah. You're totally fired.
We'll probably just keep it. In all seriousness, we'll probably keep it pretty simple.
Yeah.
I think like this tour, we've got a pretty sweet light rig.
Yeah.
We didn't have it. Tonight or last night, because the border, speaking of them, they stopped us.
Yeah, okay.
So we did a sort of mock version, which was still awesome, but because our lighting guy is the best. But it's pretty fun. This is the first tour that we've done where we've really been able to sort of produce a show. You know, elongated songs and like added little jam parts and stuff and cued them with lights and stuff. And that's really fun. So I think we could get more into doing that. But we're pretty... Since the beginning, we've kind of been pretty... punk rock like play and go, and we don't like, I think it's especially a lot of like electronic music, because there's not much happening on stage musically and there's just a guy like pushing stuff usually. Yeah. They kind of like do go crazy with the lights and pyro and all that stuff, and I think that we're kind of trying to turn that on its head a bit and like, you know, add a drummer and like maybe I think we would add a we might add one other player that kind of can do everything, like a jack of all trades who can, oh, I'm playing the bass and now I'm playing the keyboard and now I'm playing the drums.
Pan flute.
Yeah, the pan flute.
Which is really what your music is.
Pan flute solo. Yeah.
It's pan flute.
You better not touch my tambourine. Tell you what.
Don't worry. It's all yours, bro. Are you going to play some music for us?
Yes, sure. We will.
Awesome. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with us.
Thanks for
having
us.
You can hear Bob Moses on Stingray Music's Eclectic Electronic Channel, Canadian Indie, The Lush Channel, Rock Alternative, The Alternative UK, and all over Stingray Music's Vibes channels.
Wow, that's a lot of channels.
That's multifaceted.
We enjoy you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Cheers. Tune in next time. We'll be right back.